So that is my better-looking Photoshop twin. My second book just came out on Amazon. I'm not selling anything other than my book, so I'll wait while you go order it right now. For those of you who like to read, this is who I am. I don't like reading it myself. I like pictures. These are some of the brands and organizations I've spoken for in the last 5 years or so. I think I'm maybe one of the few guys in the world who's been on Fox and PBS in the same year. So I get pitchforked and burned from both sides. Now, one of the most common rationales for organizations, from you as an individual at home, to your employers, to your own firms, not taking security seriously. How many of you have heard this rationale from your friend's family or grandmother? There's nothing on my computer hacker could want. How many of you get that from your clients? If you're not raising your hands, you obviously are stoned on the chicken nuggets. Because I've heard that rationale from every single client I've ever worked with in the last 20 years. Oh, we're too small. We're just a small hospital. We're just a small financial. We're just a small bank. Yeah, somehow the words small and bank to me never ever compute. But apparently they use it quite often when we're pitching them for work. And of course, I'm only using it for checking email.
Everyone's in denial.
Isn't that a river in Egypt? Oh, sorry, the other denial. Here's a fun fact that I've used for a while. This stat is fairly scary, and fortunately, it's getting truer and more, up to a certain point. If you're one of the large organizations, this metric does not apply. This metric applies primarily to small businesses, firms with 5 to 250 employees, which is why we get to see repeat offenders having breaches every year. Anthem, Blue Cross, the federal government, they'll never go bankrupt. Gonna skip through that. Couple of short, quick studies. You know, the whole point of talk is, what are trends in financial crimes? First thing I want you to take away from this is, there are no new crimes. Computers did not create new crimes. Internet did not create new crimes. All it did is democratize the crime warfare, and it accelerated the velocity of the crimes. Go back to the old days, 1940s, 1950s. If I wanted to commit ID theft, I'd have to know where you lived, go steal your mail, file for change of address form at the postal office, and if I was a really good criminal or a good criminal gang, I might be able to do ID theft on 2, 3, 4, 5 people a year, maybe 50 in a really good year, before I got slapped with steel bracelets. Today, you can be a 10-year-old kid in Florida, or a 40-year-old guy in Russia, or a 27-something in China, and you can now steal identities on millions of people very, very quickly. The crime hasn't changed, just velocity with which it's changed. In the old days, to make real money, you had to steal a couple $100, a couple of grand to make it worth your while. Today, if you can steal 97 cents a person out of 10 million people, that's a pretty good paycheck. And if you notice in the last couple of years, we've seen a lot of charges people don't detect on their credit card statements. When was the last time you actually disputed a charge for under $10? When was the last time you disputed a charge on your card for less than $10? Less than $5? Really? It was worth your time to dispute $5?
Always.
Don't you make more money per hour than $5?
It doesn't really matter. Charge me once, charge me 3 times.
I like your attitude. I would assert that you're one of the very small minority. Most people will do a cost-benefit analysis. If the loss is less than what I make in an hour, screw it. I'm going to skip through a lot of these slides because I don't plan to read all of it to you, but if anybody wants to double check my data, I'll give you the full slide deck at the end, and it's all available on our website. This is one of my favorite crimes. It happened December 2012, New Year's Eve, a firm got broken into. New Year's Day, everybody's closed. January 2nd, the firm filed for bankruptcy. Why? Because the theft was enough for them to go, there's no way we can recoup the losses. In California, if you're an escrow firm, you have a couple of days to make good on the funds, or the regulators come after you. So in this case, the firm did a cost-benefit analysis on January 2nd, 2013, and said, we're not going to recover, might as well file for bankruptcy. I'm going to skip through law firms. How many of you work for law firms? How many work in the legal industry? Until about 5 years ago, and this is data from the FBI, until about 5-6 years ago, criminal organizations around the world, from Florida to Azerbaijan, were targeting businesses. In the last 4 or 5 years, they've realized that while Fortune 500 and large corp and large bank have gotten fairly secure, or more secure than they used to be, they're not targeting advisors. Last year, a big mining firm in Canada was up for play, a mineral resources deal worth billions of dollars. What the Canadian regulators discovered is the 5 largest law firms in Canada had all been infected with custom malware to steal data on the trade. So one of the things we advise a lot of our clients on is if you're in the advisory field, lawyers, IT consultants, accountants, and if you're lawyers, doctors, you're IT, you have access to really privileged data, and most legal security is an oxymoron. Their contracts are better than their IT. Now, why does this happen? You know, most common question I get asked is, why do we have cybercrime? Well, the obvious answer is, why do we have crime? Because we've been committing crime since we were in the caves. The other sub-answer is, US is a unique culture. The amount of cybercrime or crime we face that's committed through electronic means is greater than the rest of the world combined by a factor of 20. What makes us different? Why don't the Canadians, who are about 20th of our economy, so 5% of our economy, why don't they see 5% of our losses? Why do they see 0.05% of our losses? Why doesn't the EU, which is economically almost the same as us, and if you look at all of the EU as a whole, economically their economy is almost the same as ours, population-wise, they're almost the same as ours, in terms of crazy people with different languages, they're about the same as ours. How come their losses through digital crimes is a fraction of ours? Because culturally, we make it very easy in this country to steal from the consumers. Case in point, New York Times did a story back in 2007 on zombie computers. Why were these criminal organizations taking over grandma's PC, infecting her with 6 different viruses, sending spam out? Because they discovered it's a very quick way to make a lot of money very quickly. Yes, sir?
Are you basing that last statement about the EU based on the data breach reporting?
No, I'm basing it on the size of their economy, size of the population, and the amount of crime stats that we see. You know, the amount of credit card fraud in the US versus EU versus UK. The amount of online banking fraud that we see published by the banking industry or Visa, MasterCard. I don't disagree with that. We'll see more of the victims disclose their breaches as they're doing in the US. But when you look at data from Visa, MasterCard, Bank of England, neutral third parties, they've been pretty good at reporting the amount of losses. So while XYZ Corp may not say, hey, we got broken into, Visa, MasterCard will tell you how much did they see in credit card fraud in the UK versus EU versus the US. Yes, sir.
Well, so I'm a privacy cyber lawyer.
Sure. Sure, I will get to that.
I have another alternative theory as to why we're targeted. Similar to the way Microsoft is targeted before Linux, for the most part, a larger market share, originally. And second, English is, you know, the most common language, right? And so to attack, let's say, Italy would be a lot more effort to do and not worth it as opposed to writing a botnet for English-speaking countries.
You're not far from truth. Your data is valid. One of the reasons we get attacked so much is we have a homogenous culture, we're in English, and we have a large economy.
Right.
But the other is, as we discovered in 2007, back when he was state attorney general and not client number 9, Spitzer nailed Bank of America and a couple of others, here we go, Priceline, Travelocity, and Singular, back in 2007 for funding the spam economy. If you recall, back in the middle of the mortgage, before the mortgage crisis, we had a mortgage boom. Why were we getting so much spam to refinance your home, refinance your mortgage. Why does somebody in Estonia or Latvia or even downtown Tampa have any interest in my mortgage rates? They don't. But what they discovered, investors discovered over a couple of years, is there's a complete economy being funded to a large extent by a large corp, America. Look at Countrywide, look at Chase, look at Citi. All their brokers were buying leads for interested buyers. How did they get those leads? They were contracting with some web agency who would say, we'll get you qualified leads, $250 a lead. They paid the agency $250 a lead. Who paid somebody else $50 a lead? Who paid somebody else $10 a lead? You all the way down to the spammer who got $10 for every person who filled out a form saying, I want to refinance my mortgage. You know, this is the first time we have real case data. This is not hypothetical. This is not somebody's opinion. This is a legal settlement where we see three of the largest corporations in America actually admitting that they funded spam.
Gotta go through that. We don't care about that. And this crime,
we see this, there are cultural patterns. In the US, we make it easy. It's very easy to commit crime against consumers because, frankly, there is no software liability. You know, Mr. Weeks, thank you very much for a great presentation. You talked about developers and supply chains. My assertion is one reason we have so much crime, digital and otherwise, is because software sucks. If software was held to the same standards as potato chips, we would see a dramatic change in the software industry. In this country, only two industries have no consumer liability protections. Software, illegal drugs. And I think there's a correlation there. You know, you can go to McDonald's, buy a burger, being rest assured, it's going to be fairly safe to eat. If there's poison, if there's salmonella, if there's something, if there's mishandling at the store level, you can sue them, so will the attorney general. So will a lot of other lawyers. You get bad software, who do you sue? You can't sue anybody for it. Go for it.
Sir, I
would like to talk to you about this because, and we can do it right now, we can do it offline as well.
Perfect.
The other thing that I see that's quite frequent is, in the US we have a lot of banking fraud, online digital fraud. We don't see that in the UK. This is a true story published in one of the Florida newspapers. Guy runs a business selling remanufactured cartridge toners, does a lot of business in South America. For a couple of years, his bank's been telling him, hey Joe, you should do online banking. Remember the Bank of America ads, do banking in your underwear? Why? Because it's cheaper for them. So he signed up for online banking, and one of the Friday evening, he has one of those moments. He just wires him like $90,000, and then he realized it's still a country he's never done business with before. He calls his bank, bank manager, okay, Joe, we'll take care of you. You know, thanks for letting me know it's Saturday. I'll take care of it Monday morning. Monday morning, the bank puts a hold on about $70,000 of the funds that had not been cashed out. Tuesday afternoon, Bank of America unilaterally releases his funds because in the opinion of the BOA attorney, when you do online transactions, it is a wire transfer, and BOA has no legal reason to stop you of stop the wire transfers. So BOA let $90,000 go out of his account. And they, when he sued them for a loss of funds, they countersued, saying that because he had a Trojan on his machine, it's his fault. When the story finally hit the newspapers and TV, they settled out of court. We don't know what the restitution was. So in the US, there's still an open case whether if you have malware on your machine, are you liable or is the bank liable? In the UK, the bank's got a law passed, which said that if a customer has malware or Trojan on their machines and they lose funds, it's a customer's liability. So you know what happened? UK online banking penetration is less than 2%. In the US, it's about 70 or 80%. Because we still have no clear-cut case law that says if you have malware on your machine, you have a custom Trojan or a generic Trojan of the week, who's liable for the losses, you or your bank?
If you're using the bank's app, does that move liability to the bank? Because clearly all the banks are trying to move their lower tier customers to online banking for lower transactions.
Sure.
So if you use their app, do they hold the liability?
Not as far as I know. The question is, if you use a banking app, do they get any liability? Not as far as I know. At the end of the day, they will claim, and they have in multiple court cases, we have no control over your laptop, your desktop, your phone. You had a Trojan, you had malware. So right now, while software is fantastic, and as someone who's a geek who loves technology and toys, I love software, I love new gadgets, the real risk we run as a society is the law is lagging behind our technological skills, and the consumers are wholly unprotected. You know, you look at credit bureau reports. You know, from 1936, when Congress passed, 1937, when you passed the Social Security Act, by law, only the IRS is allowed to use Social Security numbers for income tax collection purposes. A year after the SSN Act passed, there was a wallet manufacturer in Long Island, in Hopog, who made brand new wallets, which they got a patent on, for the little windows you could put these SSN cards in. And the VP of marketing took his secretary's Social Security card, reduced it in half, changed the color from blue to red, marked it sample, stuck it in their wallets as a sample. And that year, about 4,000 Americans filed their taxes using her SSN number. You laugh. 40 years later, 1977, 10 Americans still file their taxes using an SSN number that came with their wallet. That is the first recorded case of ID theft via Social Security number. Now, legally, only the banks were allowed to use SSN numbers for, IRS was allowed to use it for tax collection purposes. In 1973, Congress amended the Social Security Act to only allow the IRS and the Treasury to use SSN numbers for tax collection purposes. Legally, your bank should not be using them for verifying your identity, giving you mortgage, credit cards, but de facto, culturally, it has become the national ID card number. What's the difference between an SSN card number and your credit card number? You walk into my shop with your credit card, I can verify within seconds, is it a valid card? What is your limit? If you lose it, you can get it revoked in a matter of minutes. Call up on the phone, go on the web, you can revoke your credit card number. SSNs, you can't verify it's actually unique. They're not unique SSN numbers. They have been reused. You can't verify the identity of a person. You can't revoke them. If you lose it, you can't call up somebody and say, I lost my SSN, get me a new one. This is a flaw built into the system, which has been exploited by organizations. And the credit bureaus come to mind. And until about the mid-90s, as a consumer, you cannot get your own credit report. They always claimed that we were not their customers. The banks and the organizations buying our credit reports were the customers. It took the Fair Credit Act of the mid-90s for the credit bureaus to actually give us our credit reports. For the first 2 years, they fought it tooth and nail. Then we got the annual get your credit report for free. And then within a couple of months of that, you notice how the air was, TV ads were full of FreeCreditReport.com, only $19.95 a month. And now they've turned what they were fighting for two decades into a cash cow.
You know, I'm going to skip with the Sony rootkit. Only thing I will say is Sony installed a rootkit on all their CDs to protect a $14.99 Beyonce CD. Frankly, I wouldn't have bought it without the rootkit. The real fallout in this country was when Sony got caught, the director of Homeland Security slapped Sony on the wrist on an open mic at a security conference, told him not to do it again. Blizzard was one of the victims of Sony attack because a lot of people use the Sony rootkit to get privileged accounts on World of Warcraft. This is a case of drive-by attacking. And my personal favorite story about all of this is when we did the DNS analysis, or when somebody else did the DNS analysis on the Sony rootkit DNS lookups, they discovered 200 black sites the US government had never admitted to in Iraq, Afghanistan, all over the world. We discovered more secret military bases and undisclosed black sites because of Beyonce than the Chinese and the Russians could ever figure out on their own. And this is one of the few times in my life I wish you were German. In Germany, a small business owner actually sued Sony in court for losses incurred due to their crappy rootkit, which they also stole from somebody else. Didn't even write their own malware. And he actually won a judgment for about 1,300 euros. How much cooler would life be if we could all sue Sony, Microsoft, Adobe for all the damage cleanup we have to do every time we get malware for their stupidity? Wouldn't that be a cool economy? Here's another fun one for you. And I don't know why I pick in Bank of America, except they do it so often. They're my poster child for bank stupidity. In this particular case, back when banks used to put your picture on their credit cards,
Amon working out of San Diego gets her card. She's been a BOA customer for years. There's some guy's photo on it. She calls and complains, that's not me. BOA goes, no, that's you. She goes, no, it's not me. I am a woman. I'm a mother. I'm not a guy. BOA finally goes, yeah, your ID was stolen. They finally looked the records and figured out some guy in Montana had used her SSN number, opened a bank account with BOA. And because he was paying his bills on time, they weren't going to close his account. So apparently, you can't commit ID theft in America if you're a BOA customer. Just make sure you pay them on time. Here's one of my favorite stories. In 2012, Walmart was caught committing bribery in Mexico. You may not care. They destroyed a World Heritage site. They pretty much raised an old pyramid to build a new Walmart because everybody needs a new Walmart. Screw old Mayan pyramids. And the fun fact is, when the story broke, Walmart stock took a 5% dive. This is a good case for talking to management about why security matters, why internal compliance matters. U.S. Walmart has been pretty clean. Their subsidiaries around the world, India, South America, Mexico, have been less than stellar. There's other blowback of that was Michael's CEO, a completely related chain. They do really good homeware stuff. They had hired a guy from Walmart to be their new CEO a couple of weeks before the Walmart bribery case broke. Case broke, their stock also took a dive. I'm going to skip the Canadian fraud. Going to skip that. If you guys want all this data, take it. You know, we talked about cultural factors earlier. In the US, committing ID theft to steal property is really difficult. It's really hard to steal somebody's house in this country, unless you're very good. In Canada, they have a funny quirk in the law. You own a house, I'm the ID thief, he's the buyer. If I can successfully steal your identity and sell your house to him, legally, you cannot reclaim your house from him. In the US, you have a stolen good, she's the owner, she can call the cops, get her house back. You're out of your money. Caveat emptor. In Canada, the culture is different. So a really big con up there is they'll find abandoned properties or properties or vacation homes, especially of older retirees. They'll move and pretend to be, you know, the grandchildren, whatever else, spend a couple of weeks, change the deeds, file some paperwork with the local county, and then sell the house to a new buyer for $500,000, $1 million, whatever the local going rate is, pocket the proceeds. The grandparents are out of a house. There is no recourse under Canadian law. This is a case of where, and by the way, what's a cyber angle to all of this? In the old days, 30 years ago, they would move into your town, steal your mail to get your data. Now that what the Toronto police discovered a couple of years ago is a lot of the criminal gangs that they were finally catching, and it's a very small group of people they're actually busting, they'd already profiled all their victims online weeks or months before the attack. They found treasure troves of complete profiles. You know, pretty much somebody was running a stealahouseinabox.com campaign. You can buy complete ID theft to buy a house crime kit in Canadian or in Canada.
Gonna skip through that.
So I'm gonna back to the mortgage crisis. And after the mortgage bubble burst, about $4 trillion got wiped off the US markets. And I said one day, you know what? Something doesn't make sense. Where did all the money go? Using that super secret thing called Google, in one afternoon, I discovered about $500 million of where the $500 trillion of where the fraud went. A couple of my favorite stories. A nurse working for Kaiser Permanente, she sold the ID of a 72-year-old woman, involved three of her colleagues in the scam, and they stole $165,000 in victim's equity. This was the first time where you had a HIPAA violation and ID theft and mortgage fraud in a single crime that was successfully prosecuted or successfully collared. Another one, Wachovia Bank, a couple of insiders rigged a scam where they knew that home office didn't know what the market in California was going to be like in the hot markets, and they were rigging the valuation of the houses working with four or five people. And my personal favorite is David Beckham. He went to buy a house. The broker he bought it from was the most successful and richest broker in Beverly Hills. A couple of months later, the broker was busted for a $40 million scam where they were going, oh yeah, that house in the hill is worth 20 mil, house in the gulch. Locals knew it was worth maybe 2 mil. home office in New York doesn't know, and they were fraudulently going, no, that's an $8 million house, and pocketing the proceeds. All this crime done online, very quickly, for lots of money.
We talked about supply chain risks with leaks and software supply chain. Here's your overall supply chain. Back when a couple of years ago, we had the pet food scandal, poison pet food.
Well, it turns out, whether you buy Purina or a lot of the major brands, one company out of Canada controls about makes a pet food for most of your manufacturers. There are very few independent manufacturers left in the country. When the story broke, these guys had a one-third stock drop overnight. This is a case that was concentrated supply chains can be really poisonous, pardon the pun.
Gonna skip through all of that. Oh, here's something you're gonna like.
When you go traveling, how many of you are truly honest with your expense receipts? How many of you are lying? We all pad our expense receipts. In China, they just do it Chinese style. They busted a warehouse with $147 billion worth of fake receipts. One warehouse. The police suspect there are about 20 more when they busted this criminal gang. And why do these guys get busted? For not paying sufficient bribes. There are warehouses full where you can actually buy everything from hotel receipts to bills of lading. A couple of people they busted out of the scam. One guy claimed his company was listed on NASDAQ. He showed POs for American corporations. Somebody else showed his company was very healthy. Here's their receipts, here's their full financials, all built on receipts they bought for a penny on the dollar.
Francisco, one of my favorite sad stories.
In 2005, 2006, one of the security researchers showed how poor ATM security was. A lot of them had default passwords. Wire did a story on it, a whole bunch of TV shows did a story on it. Within 2 weeks, ATM manufacturers shipped ATMs with secure passwords. Do you know what happened to most of them? 95% of the ATMs that were shipped with secure passwords within a week of deployment were set back to the insecure insecure passwords we've known since 1972. Because Chase, Citi, BOA, you name it, most of the banks did the math and realized that if they were to improve ATM security, it would cost more than what they were losing through insecure ATMs.
Gonna skip that. A couple of case stories for you to know. Back in 2005,
a couple of guys went to BJ's warehouse. They bought a laptop, a Wi-Fi sniffer, and they broke BJ's security in their Wi-Fi network. This was the first time the FTC nailed a corporation for poor security, and they basically said that using insecure Wi-Fi on your local LAN and not protecting data in motion was a violation of federal law. The FTC is my favorite agency in the US government. There is no law that says the FTC has to enforce cybersecurity. They looked at the US Constitution and inserted Commerce Clause for their authority. And since 1998, they've been the best agency at actively prosecuting digital malfeasance. This is the first time you have real settlement that says you have to protect data in motion on your local LAN. And the punchline, of course, is they broke the WEP at BJ's in 2005. Never mind, we've been shipping WPA since 2003. You can actually go to BJ's and buy new routers with WPA2 enabled. So apparently BJ's security didn't know which aisle to buy the Wi-Fi routers in. Again, back in 05, DSW Warehouse, they had no online presence, just a brochureware site. A very simple privacy policy. When you went to return shoes, they asked you for your social security, for your driver's license and a bunch of other ID. They got broken into, and the FTC nailed them for roughly $10 million in penalties. And what the FTC said is that by giving consumers a written privacy policy and not honoring it, they were engaging in unfair and deceptive business practices. By the way, this got reaffirmed just 2 weeks ago when Wyndham International lost their case against the FTC. So those of you looking for ammo on why we need better security practices at work, you have case law going back to 05.
By the way, I'm not a lawyer, I'm just an IT nerd. We got tired of clients going, why do we have to do it? Gonna skip choice point, gonna skip click fraud.
Remember in Barings Bank in 1995, Nick Gleason, trader, went rogue, lost $1.4 billion, and his bank got sold in bankruptcy. Flash forward to 2008, 13 years later, Société Générale. These guys lost $7.1 billion. In both cases, the mistake was exactly the same. He had one trader who had been denied promotions, denied bonuses. He had worked in front office, back office. When he moved from back office to front office to risk analysis, they never took his privileges away. And because he never took vacations and he worked really hard, when his colleagues wanted to goof off, they would give him their passwords. And again, my personal favorite punchline out of this is when German Gervail was nailed, Nick Gleason said, "Yeah, 13 years, they haven't learned a damn thing. Only difference is, wish I'd taken more." This is proof that most organizations don't learn. You can have all the policies in the world. In Société Générale, SocGen had really good risk control policies. They had really good ones, but they did not enforce them. And the other sad story is, had they had a corporate culture that said you can admit to your mistakes in the ombudsman office, had Gervail come clean 6 months or a year earlier, they would have made something like a multi-billion dollar profit. But because you couldn't tell his managers, by the way, I've been breaking the rules and trading on the side, and I made like $6 billion, he could not disclose his managers who made him money. In the end result, he cost him $7.1 billion. This is really good reason why not only should you have good policies that you enforce, but have a come clean option if you can in your organization. People are gonna break the rules. Somebody's gonna break rules in their favor, somebody's gonna break rules in your favor. Letting people say mea culpa might avoid large losses. Gonna skip that. Now, what do we have in this country? We got 105 laws last time I checked on data privacy. Everything from federal stuff to the 50 state laws to PCI. Then you got Canada. In the US, if you're a business owner or a compliance guy, this is 105, you're never gonna keep on top of this. Nobody really does. Move over to Canada, you deal with one law, and you got three provinces with higher standards. So basically, most you have to comply with four different regs. It's a lot saner. You've got one person in Ottawa that you can complain to, they're Pipitazar. They have a much saner policy towards consumer policy and cybersecurity. How do we know this? Back in the early 2000s, Google and Microsoft both spent hundreds of millions of dollars creating health portals. Google with Google Health and Microsoft MSN Health Vault. They're both doing an end run around HIPAA, because under HIPAA, as consumers, we can give our data to anybody, but they cannot get it from our hospital without our approvals or our pharmacies. When Google and Microsoft unveiled health portals to Canada, the Pipitazar called them both in office and said, "Ladies and gentlemen, you're breaking my country's laws. Either fix your product or get out of my country." Within 2 weeks of that meeting, Canadians had better privacy controls in their health data than the Americans do. Even though Google and Microsoft are both, last I checked, American corporations. I'm not exactly sure what happens to the bits when they cross the 48th parallel, but all of a sudden the more privacy bit gets set. If one of you can figure out at routing level how we get a magical privacy bit when it crosses the 48th parallel, I'd like to know. Because magically the Canadians get better privacy than Americans do. Every law we know has all these fields you must hold sacred, PCI, HIPAA, you name it. Latanya Sweeney, a phenomenal researcher, did a study about 6 years ago, maybe 7 years ago now, where she demoed that you could revert de-anonymize 87% of Americans if all you knew was their zip code, date of birth, and gender. Your gender, gee, that's kind of easy to tell for anybody not named Kate, isn't it? That's a joke, folks. Zip code, how many times do we put our zip code every time we buy gas at the pump or every time we fill out a receipt? Date of birth, how many times have you gotten happy birthday messages from Facebook? How many times have you disclosed your date of birth? About 10 years ago, an ice cream chain closed in the Midwest. They've been around for like 150 years. And the firm had no real assets to speak of. Stores, they were old. Fixtures, who cares about, you know, other than a couple of 50s shake mixers, who cared? Their real asset turned out to be their 130 years of birthday books. Because every time they got a new customer, you know, kids would put in their date of birth so they'd get free ice cream cone on their birthday. This was their most valuable asset, the date of birth. When was it Mitt Romney? I forget who the governor of California was at the time. It was Mitt Romney, the guy right after him. Had a really good idea. State of Massachusetts, like most states, has a really large healthcare program. Let's take data on state employees, anonymize it to the best of their ability, and make it available to researchers. As governor, he could do that. Somebody spent $20 or $25, got the state date of birth records, de-anonymized the data, and mailed the government his health records. So next time somebody tells you we anonymize our data, liar. The hardest problem I know in computer science right now is properly anonymizing data, because de-anonymizing is so damn easy. So when Facebook, Google, your hospital, they're anonymizing your data for research purposes, I would take that with a large barge of salt.
Gonna go to the SSN story, we're gonna skip that.
I got a question for you guys. Would your life be easier if we nuked Adobe? If we got rid of Flash?
Yeah.
Why is it that they can ship us this malware, malware, and we have to pay for the cost of cleanup? Last time I bought some food that was tainted, take it back to the grocery store, they refunded it cheerfully. Last time McDonald's had a salmonella outbreak, they caught the supply chain. They ate the cost of bad beef. You know, I look at Adobe, Amazon, Microsoft, and I look at Johnson & Johnson. Every time I talk to software guys, and I speak at IC Squared and ISSA a lot, the biggest complaint I hear is, well, software's too difficult, it's too complicated. Zero day, we can't protect against zero day. You're right, we can't protect against zero day. But look at Johnson & Johnson. Back in the 80s, when some random crank went into a random drugstore, took one bottle of Tylenol, tampered with it, put it back on the shelf, J&J could have done what the industry did, which was a shadow recall. You don't admit to it, you don't make any public announcements, you just have your buyers go in, buy the stock, replace it. That was the industry standard. J&J made a corporate decision to go public with that breach, and they ate the cost of recalling all the pills of Tylenol, and in the process, they said, how do we prevent this? And we came up with a plastic wrapper on the pills. If J&J was in 2011, 15, I suspect they would patent 10 different ways on how to wrap your pills. J&J made a corporate decision that for the common good of humanity, they would make that patent freely available to everybody. One corporation took one stand, improved security for all of us. When was the last time we had a software vendor take that stand? Look at seatbelts. In 1950, seatbelts were optional. Many manufacturing, they hadn't been invented yet. Volvo invented them, the sliding lock mechanism so you can't tug it too hard, and they made the patent freely available to every car manufacturer in the world. And that's the reason why we have seatbelts everywhere. They could have put it under patent lock and key. I assert, as software developers, as IT professionals, it's time for us to recognize that software, until this year, until today, has been where shoes were in the 15th century. If you were in the Middle Ages Europe, you bought shoes in town A, when you went to town B, the shoemaker made completely different shoes. There was no standardization. There were no standards for anything. Each town was unique, each shoemaker was unique. How Bob made his shoes versus how Gene made his shoes are completely different. It took the rise of guilds and professionalism for us to have shoe standards. So the shoes you and I wear today, do we know who made them? No, at best we know the brand that's logoed on the side. We don't know who made them, we don't know where they're made, do we really care? As long as they look good and they were a good price on sale, do we care where they were made? No. I assert it's time for us to actually look at, as responsible citizens, of our communities, of our countries, of our economies. How do we upgrade software security so we don't poison the well every single time? As Week said, how many apps get downloaded with 10-year-old bad code? We have to sanitize the gene pool.
In 2010, if you're a Dell Enterprise customer and you bought their top-of-the-line servers, they actually shipped the top-of-the-line replacement motherboards with malware built in.
And for 2 years, they kept it quiet and blamed the customers for faulty servers.
08,
HP shipped their management keys to ProLiant servers with factory installed malware. Chrysler can't do this. They have a software defect. They have to recall 1.4 million cars, or at least update them. HP took no responsibility for this. Why? Because the software vendors, they have no legal liability. One of my favorite stories, how many of you see picture frames at work? Remember the dawn of time when these things didn't exist? Like 05, 06, then by 07 somebody invented them, by 09? Look at the number of picture frames sold just at Walmart. Almost 10 million in 2009. There were supply chain quality controls on the hardware. USB port had to work. It had to not burn when you plugged it in. The screen had to work. There was no quality control in the software. I'll let you guess how many of these came with factory built-in malware.
I once got from a vendor, right, as one of those, you know, take-home gifts.
Yeah.
Some sort of picture keyframe.
Mm-hmm.
Right, and I ran it through, you know, tried to plug it in to upload the picture,
mm-hmm.
and the antivirus came back and said, "Hey, this thing's got Trojan on it."
Yep. Just last week, police in North Dakota are now legally authorized to fly drones with tasers. Now, how long do you think it'll be until some script kiddie owns drones with tasers?
Bizarre. They allowed him to do that. You know that's going to get hacked.
A friend of mine is James Lynn, head of security at Sophos. He does a great IoT demo. He went to Amazon. He bought a Internet of Things, you know, a programmable plant water feeder. And programmable light bulbs. Here's what he discovered. IoT security in 2014 is internet 1997. No user authentication, no validation, no bound control. So he took a light bulb. You know, you're supposed to be able to turn it on and off using just a soap string. He turned it on, off and on some like 1,000 times a second, set his room on fire. He took a plant feeder where, you know, you put attach it to water, it'll feed your plant, and you can feed your plant remotely over the internet. Well, he used that to cause a flood. So IoT, it's not the Internet of Things, it's the Internet of Insecure, Stupid Things. OPM breach, we know OPM got broken into in 4 million, 12 million, who the hell cares, the number's large. We learned just last week that the Chinese and Russian governments have already used the OPM data to root out the US spies. Gee, who didn't see that coming? Smart TVs. In my house, we have three rules that are not negotiable. There is no social media allowed at the house. The kids have no social media or email accounts that I don't control. And there are no smart devices allowed. Samsung smart TVs are telling the privacy policies that if you have turned audio controls on, which you have to use the damn thing, TV on, TV off, because apparently pressing the button remote is too hard, difficult for us, it will record your conversations, transcribe them. So don't talk about anything sensitive in front of your Samsung smart TV, your Motorola smartphone, and why did the skip? On your Motorola smartphones or your Xbox 360, because not only will the Xbox 360 voice controls, if you enable them, record what you're doing, but every now and then Kinect will also take pictures. So the smart gadgets are privacy threats. You know, we've all known about Chrysler. What most people don't know is GM's OnStar. The app has a small flaw. It uses a pinned SSL key on their mobile app. Semi-mechanic car created an app called OwnStar, and he owned all of GM's OwnStar vehicles. Not content to sit on his laurels, 2 weeks later, he used a similar flaw to remotely control and shut down BMW, Mercedes, and a bunch of other brands. And why is this thing going on different slides?
Yeah.
Let's stop that. And of course, Progressive Insurance. You know, we all love Flo, don't we? And get the Progressive app that'll save you on your car insurance based on your driver's habits. How come she never told you that, oh, this is a complete privacy flaw and we've just put 2 million vehicles at risk? Because you can use the Progressive Snapshot to shut down your car, steal your car, and leave no traces. About 2 years ago, Channel 11 interviewed me for a story on car thefts in Long Beach. They couldn't figure out how people are opening car doors, stealing valuables. Well, we know how they're doing it. They're spoofing the smart keys, smart fobs. David Beckham, for some reason, my second favorite punchline on this. So because he is who he is, he gets given these amazing cars from car manufacturers, the brands that sponsor him. BMW gave him a nice 200,000 pound, you know, roughly $350,000 car as a free gift because he's David Beckham. He parked in front of his flat in London. Car got stolen. No broken glass. They couldn't figure out how they stole, how the car got stolen. Flash forward 6 months later, BMW discovers a lovely flaw in all their high-end vehicles. If you buy their cheap cars, you're perfectly fine, because they don't sell you all the smart electronics. The high-end cars, ones over 75K and higher, well, there's a part of the car that they don't monitor, because that's where the OBD port is. And the criminals figured out that if you attack the car in that one little physical vector point, you can steal a car nobody knows. And this is only good if you buy the high-end cars from BMW, Porsche, Audi, Ferrari, Mercedes. So it's okay for the people like us who actually don't buy expensive cars, like New Yorkers. I personally think that we should have a new MAD campaign, Mothers Against Dangerous Developers. Who's with me? Who's going to join MAD? How do we win the war? I said, look at history. In the 1980s, if you recall, a lot of doctors are quitting medicine because cost of premiums are going too high. A lot of doctors quit medicine to become plumbers, lawyers, janitors, anything but a doctor. Anesthesiologists said, why are we getting sued so often? Why are premiums going up through the roof? They looked at it and they realized that when they started the study, 1 out of 5,000 deaths in the hospital were directly attributable to anesthesiologist error. They went on a 10-year program of retraining how they train new anesthesiologists, how they recertify existing ones. They came up with new checklists, new processes. They dropped the death rate from 1 in 5,000 to 1 in 200 to 1 in 300,000. Their malpractice claims, what they were sued for, dropped 46% from 332,000 in 1970 to 180,000 in the 1990s. Their premiums dropped 37%. When was the last time your car insurance premium dropped? When was the last time your home premium dropped? This is almost a miracle that an American insurance companies would drop premiums. Why did they do that? Because the anesthesiologist improved the state of their art. They could have said, not our problem. We're doing a great job. Not our problem. You know what? It's human error. Sorry, dude. Bugs happen. Sorry, dude. Sometimes you are just so hungover, you give them the wrong dosage. And early, by 05-06, EU spent about a couple of $100 million on a multi-year study, how we improve healthcare in the EU. And they discovered the most powerful tool for extending human life once checked in the hospital. Do you want to guess what that tool was? What was this brand new application that was so amazing that it's saving the EU several $1 billion a year? Shout out some guesses. What was this new amazing platform? Guys, I'm waiting for the name of a web app. It's a tool. It's something you can actually use. I'll give you the joke. After spending several $100 million in multi-year studying in all the major hospitals in the EU, they discovered that the most important tool for saving patient lives was a checklist. A freaking checklist. Atul Gawande, a phenomenal researcher and a doctor, wrote a book called The Checklist Manifesto that based on that study and his experiences in the US. You ever notice you go to an airplane that before you take off, your pilot's gone through several hundred checklists? When was the last time your developer's checklist extended to more than grab coffee, look cool, turn the computer on? When was the last time your developers went through a proper checklist before submitting code, before compiling code? When was the last time your application developers had a checklist for actually testing anything? In our business, what we discovered is we're an IT consulting firm. The two most important tools we've developed in the last 3 years that have transformed our business, our profitability, and our client happiness, SOPs and checklists. Yes, we use really cool tools and wikis and all that stuff to implement it. At the end of the day, most important tool is a printed checklist. Did we say hello to the user? Did we ask for their problem? Did we actually solve the problem correctly? Did we follow back with the user and confirm the problem was resolved? Did we document what we found? Simple checklist saved more lives than any additional tool in the last 30 years. How many of you are willing to take that challenge on? That the best way to save lives and save our jobs and build better technology is to give up our lust for new toys and actually go back to the basics. War on drugs? I say we declare it's failed. And if we don't, look at the data. Before they legalized marijuana, California was spending something like $20 billion a year in law enforcement fighting pot. They legalized it. And a year later, they made something like $100 million in taxes. $20 billion spend, $100 million income. I don't know about you, but I kind of like this a lot better. The question for you is, as you build corporate security policies, do you have the ability to let your users, your colleagues, your customers report vulnerabilities? Are you looking at the data and going, yeah, IT is a cost center, or are you looking at how we turn to a profit center? What activities are we currently banning, can we legalize and bless our users with that will save lower costs and increase profitability? One of the things I engage with a lot of our clients in is sanity checking. How many things are we saying no to that were appropriate 5 years ago, 10 years ago, 6 years ago, that may not no longer be true today? I recommend you go to YouTube and grab a video of mine, What to Teach Your Kids, Employees, and Interns About Social Media, because as Falvinch said so brilliantly, on the internet, there's no Fourth Amendment. Everything that you say can and will be used against you by anybody, now or decades in the future. You are all a lost cause. You're over the age of 21. I assert that we need to teach our 5-year-olds, our 10-year-olds, our 12-year-olds, our 13-year-olds how to cross the internet safely, how to behave appropriately online. If we don't teach our kids 20 years from now, when we're retiring and they're paying our taxes, we'll be the ones screwed. You know, in 1937, Congress made a small mistake. They make a lot of small mistakes every day. In the war between the left, who didn't want a national ID number, who wanted SSNs, and the right, who didn't want a national ID number, they compromised. And they came up with the Social Security Act, which is a joke in terms of security, verifiability, accessibility. Facebook, a couple of years ago, wanted to sell you, issue you driver's licenses. They want to become our default ID. So does Google, with their Google Auth. So does Twitter. At some point, somebody is going to win the authentication war. In India, 800 million people, 2.5 times the population of the United States, all have a national ID card funded by the government, built by a vendor who got paid 50 cents per biometric card. Did they build any security into it? I'll quote the minister in charge of the program when they asked about whatever privacy rights. And she said, listen, man, these people, the poorer people, they live 10 to a room. They don't care about privacy. Sad part is that technology is now being exported to a lot of other countries. And at some point, we may end up buying that technology because it's got a large user base. It's got market share. Security, what's that? I'm going to skip all of that. A couple of victories for you. Just last week, when a judge told the FBI get a warrant before he acquired data, a Baltimore lawyer working with one of the national organizations is going to go through 2,000 cases in Baltimore and see how many of them were illegally prosecuted because the FBI and local police broke state and federal law in deploying stingrays and not admitting their usage. My personal favorite, just last week, the chair of the Federal Trade Commission, in this war we have on Twitter and news media about encryption, had something smart to say. Each of us can play an important role in protecting our information. Encryption and end-user protections can raise issues of access to law enforcement. Some argue that they should be designed with backdoors.
Come back, you.
Yay. However, this debate called crypto war is hardly new. It's been going on in this country about 40 years. In the 1990s, we had the Clipper Jack. We mandated weak crypto. SSL, Beast, Poodle, all these attacks can be traced back to the Clinton White House and the crypto wars of 1996. This is the only government official who's publicly gone and said, we need strong crypto. We need better encryption and backdoors, law enforcement, otherwise will get misused. How do we know this? Since the dawn of time, the US government has backdoors in phone systems. ES7 was broken the day it was shipped. In 2005 or 2004, in the European, the Olympics or a big football match, the mafia kidnapped an engineer, had him backdoor into the Italian ESS phone systems. They got all the traffic data, and they made a lot of money. At the end, he was killed. We know about 2 years ago, Wired broke a story that the Mexican mob, the various cartels, are kidnapping telecom engineers and building sophisticated, state-of-the-art telecom networks for the drug trade. The first use of data mining was in Colombia back in the 80s. One of the big drug barons, somehow they acquired mainframe. They hooked it up to the local phone exchange illegally because they had to subordinate the local phone people. And every time somebody called from the US Embassy, they would trace back and see if it was one of their numbers. This was the first case of data mining for commercial purposes. Why do I tell you all of this? Because if we build weak technology, shoddy technology, weak crypto, long before law enforcement uses for legal purposes, script kiddies and criminals will use it to destroy our lives and destroy our economy. So where you can, write strong software. Where you can, demand better security. Because at the end of the day, the wallet you're protecting is yours. Gonna skip that. This is the Wyndham case. So Wyndham hotel chain, they have a very strong privacy policy, at least it reads very well. Somebody walked into a retail, one of their hotels, which they don't own, it's a franchise. The franchise was broken into. They had malware across a lot of their point of sale systems. Wyndham sued in court and said, FTC, get off. You have no legal authority to sue us. Thankfully, the judge said, screw you, Wyndham. The FTC has the authority to prosecute you. Wyndham lost the case. This is the first time now we have official court statements, court case that says the FTC has cybersecurity authority in the United States. So next time you're talking to your board members or your CEOs or your clients about cybersecurity, they say, go, who's going to make me? Welcome to the granddaddy of law enforcement. These guys don't take cases very often. They don't prosecute every Tom, Dick, and Harry. But every time the FTC has gone to case and sanctioned somebody, they have made landmark precedents. This is the one agency with current cases you may want to follow if you're in the cybersec field. Small plug for myself. This is my new book. It's on Amazon. Buy it now. Contact info. Questions, comments, feedback. Yes, sir.
Just to be clear, the FTC only prosecutes you if you misinform your customers.
Not quite. The Federal Trade Commission, their power in the Constitution is to regulate interstate commerce. Pre-telephones, say pre-1900, you literally had to do business in multiple states. The courts have ruled that when you use the phones and now email, that is engaging interstate commerce. You have a website, it's interstate commerce. So whether you misinform your customers, whether you lie to your customers, or you engage in business practices that are non-competitive.
But in terms of cybersecurity?
In terms of, it goes back to their mandate. So you don't have to just lie to your customers. If you say we're going to do X, right, and you do Y, that's a violation of your agreements.
Right.
If the industry practices we're going to use WPA2 and you use WEP because it's cheaper for you, that is a violation of the FTC statutes.
Right.
If the industry practices to build double-barreled gas tanks, they don't explode, and you build the Pinto 2015, that's a violation of the FTC rules. That's where the Federal Trade Commission will come in because you're now engaging in unfair or deceptive business practices. Their mandate is very large, it's very broad. It is not circumscribed by some new law that Congress passed in the last 5 years in between goofing off on CNN. It goes back to the US Constitution.
Right, but how many cases have they prosecuted in the last, I don't know, 9 years? The last
a lot.
It was like 89 or something.
Right, so the court case that they actually prosecute, it takes a lot for the FTC to A, investigate you, B, it takes a lot more for them to actually penalize you. Normally, they'll announce that they're investigating you, and if you take corrective action, They won't penalize you. This is the same approach Health and Human Services takes to HIPAA violations. You know, unless it's you really, really have to be really egregious, really piss them off for them to come down on you. If you make an honest mistake, they're not going to jail you. They're not in the business of shutting companies down. They're not in the business of jailing people, unless you really go out of their way. You know, historically, for HIPAA violations, the cost per record for violations that a U.S. government settled is about $1,200, I think, maybe lower. But there was one small medical practice that basically said, "Screw you to the government." Fought them for years, and their settlement was a couple of million dollars, something like $11,000 per record. And a Blue Cross Blue Shield isn't spending $11,000, even $1,100 a record for loss. They're spending maybe $200 a record lost for their cleanup and cost containment.
Right, but in terms of regulating,
yeah,
right, or just enforcing regulations, I think that's the only agency that's doing kind of a better job within the United States, but still they're only been able to prosecute 89 cases or something.
Right. So the FTC doesn't take a large volume, but what they do does set case law. And then the beauty of it is, once they set a standard, now all the attorney generals and local prosecutors can point to that and use that at local law enforcement levels. So they do one thing. Well, you got 50 states. You've got, what, 300 cities in this country? So you got 50 state attorney generals. You've got 300 DAs. You got 600 sub-DAs. You know, it's almost like the Amway pyramid scheme. They do one thing and it reflects and impacts several thousand people. So when the FTC makes landmark cases, it's not just the 150 people or so in DC that have now set case law. They've just unleashed the force of the US federal government behind it. That's why they're very careful at what they do. They don't make mistakes. I have yet to see a case that where the FTC won and then it was renegotiated. They are very careful what they do, and they apply some very smart people in consumer safety, electronics, cyber, physical, you name it. They're very, very careful people. Any other questions or comments? I realize I'm way over time. Feedback? Was this worth your time?
Yes.
Did anybody live tweet it? No one live tweeted? This is 2015, people. If you're giving me your phones, at least live tweet it.